I'm Jonathan Fanton, the interim director of the Roosevelt House Public Policy Institute. We are located in the historic homes of Eleanor and Franklin Roosevelt and Franklin mother Sarah. I say homes because, as most of you know, they were two separate townhouses that had a way of coming together when Mother Roosevelt broke through and made it one big happy family, and we've now have institutionalized that by joining the townhouses. The Roosevelt Institute offers two undergraduate programs, one in domestic public policy, the other in international human rights. We sponsor research, and I think very importantly, have public programs such as those that bring us together tonight. Tonight we welcome William Dobson for a discussion of his important new book. I've really read this, so there's no cover on it. The Dictator's Learning Curve. He helps us understand how both authoritarian regimes and their opposition are using new techniques in the struggle to advance or restrain the evolution of democracy. Mr. Dobson notes in his introduction, and I quote, "Today's dictators are far more sophisticated, savvy, and nimble than they once were. Faced with growing pressures, the smartest of them neither hardened their regimes into police states nor closed themselves off from the world. Instead, they learned and adapted. For dozens of authoritarian regimes, the challenge posed by democracy's advance led to experimentation, creativity, and cunning. Modern authoritarians have successfully honed new techniques, methods, and formulas for preserving power, refashioning dictatorship for the modern age." But as we will hear, this book is as much and maybe more than the dictator's learning curve. Mr. Dobson gives equal time to the learning curve of the opposition and the global conversation among dissidents about how to mount nonviolent protest and revolutions. And he helps us understand the importance of local opposition in eroding a regime's legitimacy, puts in perspective the role of international actors like the U.S. and the U.N., and offers practical insights about the patient path to democratic change. William J. Dobson is a distinguished journalist, scholar, and foreign policy commentator. He was a Truman Scholar, an award that recognizes exceptional college students interested in public service. He holds both a law degree and a master's in East Asian Studies from Harvard. In 2006, Mr. Dobson was named a Young Global Leader by the World Economic Forum, and later was a visiting scholar at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. He's published articles and op-eds in the New York Times, the Wall Street Journal, the Boston Globe, among others. And more recently, he's produced a series of online articles for the Washington Post that use the first recorded accounts of the Egyptian military's human rights abuses of female prisoners to highlight the brutalities of modern authoritarianism. Prior to his current post as the politics and foreign affairs editor for Slate, Mr. Dobson served as managing editor for Foreign Policy magazine. He was Newsweek International Senior Editor for Asia and the Associate Editor of Foreign Affairs. He can be heard on major news outlets, including ABC, CNN, CBS, NPR, and more. This is a really, really interesting book. And after he and I talk for half an hour or so, we'll then open it up to your questions. And then around 6:40, we will break. He will be upstairs to autograph copies of the book that will be available upstairs. So you're in for a real treat on a very hot summer day. This will be a hot conversation, but with cool analysis underpinning it. So Will, come on up. Welcome.
Thank you.
The sound system here is not perfect, so if you have trouble, it's probably better to just do this.
Yeah.
If you have trouble hearing us, speak up. Let me begin by asking, what inspired you to write The Dictator's Learning Curve? And and I gather you really didn't rely so much on secondary resources as getting out in the field and doing it. And what did you discover along the way that surprised you?
Well, as in most things in life, there's sort of the moment, there are the ideas and the things that interest you. And so I was interested by these questions for a long time. And in fact, I had the idea for the book years ago, but it was just a matter of trying, finding the opportunity and maybe the courage to take the risk to actually go and do it. It's a sad sort of statement about sort of the state of international journalism today that to be able to write a book, you almost, or in my case, literally had to leave your job in order to do it, you know, because they're just, the demands are too much. But in a more discreet moment for me, if I could sort of, was there a moment? I was at lunch with someone named Peter Ackerman, who some people here may know, and Peter has devoted much of his time and fortune in recent years to trying to combat, help those activists in countries who are trying to combat regimes such as this. And he'd invited me to lunch because he had a new endeavor that he wanted to tell a journalist about, which was putting together these video games to teach activists how to hone their strategies in a secure environment like playing a video game rather than just going out into the streets. And so he was telling me about this, along with some of his associates, and they're explaining the game to me and how it works and the thinking that went into it, and it was very interesting. And at some point I sort of asked, well, wait a minute, is it a two-player game? And they sort of, the table sort of went silent, and they just sort of looked at me, and I said, well, I mean, let me rephrase, can I be the dictator? And that did not go over very well. And they said, we have no interest in training people how to oppress their populations. There's plenty of that going on as it is. And I said, no, that's not my point. My point is not that necessarily, but rather that, like chess, when you're learning to play chess, you need to be able to learn to think from the point of view of your opponent as well. You have to see both sides. So if we can agree that this is a dynamic struggle, then isn't it the case that these activists could learn by putting on the hat of the regime too? I wasn't going to persuade anyone at that lunch about this, but I came away from it thinking, you know what, this is something I actually want to examine. And to do this, I want to do it by actually going to all these places and meeting these people firsthand.
We were talking earlier, and I gather your trips were not without some risk. How did you choose the countries you were going to spotlight? And give us a story or two about doing the research.
Sure. Yeah, there's nothing scientific about the list. You could come up with a very good list that would include completely different countries. What I wanted to do, though, is I wanted to identify regimes that I thought were actually showing some degree of sophistication. I wanted them to be from different corners of the world. I wanted, in making the comparisons across regimes, I wanted to be able to control for, if you will, different political culture, different history. I wanted there to be the variation among them. In their tactics. And so I traveled to Egypt, Russia, China, Venezuela, and Malaysia. So you know, there's a great deal of diversity, and there's a lot of common denominators among them as well. You know, in the case of, in terms of risk, or, you know, I mean, it's sort of a truth that you were often safest back in the 80s in a totalitarian system. There was very little crime. So you're very safe. As anyone who's traveled to China knows, China is a perfectly safe place to travel to. The opposite side of that, a place that is less controlled as an environment, maybe one of the least controlled that I've ever been to, is a place like Venezuela, where the lengths that I needed to go to, the amount of the attention that NGO activists were giving me to make sure, no, did you hear me? I really mean it. You have to take this flight into Caracas. You have to arrive on the red eye. If you arrive between 9 p.m. and 1 a.m., which is when most flights currently arrive, and you take a cab, the cab driver will drive you to the kidnapper because they're in on it. It's 45 minutes from the airport to the city center. You don't want to travel that road during those hours in any circumstance. My cab driver never stopped at a red light in any of the days I was ever in Venezuela, because that's when you get carjacked. You don't stop. There's an informal curfew in place today in Venezuela where really the only public places that sort of exist now are malls. So as opposed to the places I thought I should be staying, no, they said, no, the best hotels are actually hotels that are inside a mall because you have layers of security. There's sort of, I never actually completely understood until I left Venezuela. I took a couple trips, and when I would come back after having been in Venezuela for a few weeks, just the sort of amount of, just the sort of, you would sigh because you sort of realize for the first time in 3 weeks you weren't looking over your shoulder, and you forget, you don't realize how much you're internalizing that tension while you're there. And to think that these people are living there like this under these conditions, I mean, it's very difficult to operate. It's very difficult to run a rally. You're not going to have a rally at night because you can't. It's not safe. No one will attend.
You wrote, and I quote, "The dictator in his learning curve seeks ways of renewing dictatorship to keep it resilient, agile, and in some way effective. A basic goal is to keep the people apathetic and uninvolved. The challenge for the government was creating the appearance of greater freedom without inadvertently granting any freedom that created a meaningful threat to its dominion." So tell us some of the techniques, the new techniques. And who has done this well? If you were to give a score, a grade to the dictator's learning curve, who's come up at most rapidly and effectively?
Vladimir Putin would be at the top of the class. I mean, if you when we think about dictatorship, you know, just in sort of the common perception of it, we often are sort of thinking about sort of a 20th century definition. We are imagining sort of the slow, lumbering behemoth, something like a dinosaur, whether it be, you know, the Soviet Union, all of its final days, or sort of an insecure South American banana republic. And we, when we think about the tools that these regimes had, really not very long ago, they were much more blunt instruments than what these regimes deploy today. You know, we think of Stalin and the millions of people sent to the Gulag. We think of Mao's revolutionary campaigns. We think of Pol Pot's killing fields. Now, dictatorships have far more forces arrayed against them. I mean, with the collapse of the Soviet Union, they lost their chief sponsor in many cases. The expansion of the democracy promotion business after the collapse of the Soviet Union, enormous amount of pressure exerted on these regimes. When the Chinese Communist Party wanted to declare martial law in Tiananmen Square in 1989, they literally pulled the plug on CNN. Literally pulled the plug. Today, that would be captured, if people were to assemble in Tiananmen Square, it would be captured on a million iPhones. So the entire environment has changed that they have to work in. And as a result, the costs to running a regime this way are incredibly high. So in fact, one, you know, sort of why, maybe why Putin would come out on the top is that Putin was actually stationed in Dresden in the late 1980s. He was in a quintessential totalitarian state, East Germany, from 1985 to the end. He watched it collapse, and early on as president has actually said, "I understood then that a system built on walls could never last." So when I talked to Russian dissidents in Moscow, they would say, you know, our constitution is every bit as good as yours. It has all the rights and privileges written in it, just as yours does. But the difference is that the only right that's actually available to us is the right to leave. And, you know, in a sense, so therefore, you know, it's not a system built on walls. It's actually a system built on passports that Putin is able to help maintain control. So what are these tools, these methods? If you're a dissident group in Moscow, it's much more likely that you'll be visited by health inspectors or tax inspectors than have your group forcibly arrested. They will arrive. They will want to see your paperwork. Your paperwork will not be in order. It will not be in order. It's very hard for it to be in order, to be fair, because the rules are always changing. But for that, you will enter in a legal process where you will have a right to appeal, which you will lose. But through this process, that group will be shuttered. In much the same way, in a place like Venezuela, laws are written very broadly, but then they're used like a scalpel against those that the government deems to be a threat. So an activist in Venezuela said to me, you know, you could say that essentially in Venezuela, Hugo Chavez's rule of thumb is sort of, for my friends, everything, for my enemies, the law. It's a very effective tool. They speak the language of human rights. They speak the language of democracy. You know, if you take statements from the Egyptian government in 2010 or 2009, they sound like they could have come out of Oslo. But you know, they understood that vernacular very well. All these regimes hold elections. They all do. But whereas, and, you know, of course, the Soviet Union did too. But the Soviet Union won with 99%. 99% doesn't happen now, except from the most insecure regimes, because everyone realizes that it's complete fraud. It's obviously absurd. And what's the point of going through those motions if it's you're going to advertise it as a fraud? So 70% is the new 99%. It's much better to appear to win a contested election. Otherwise, why go through it at all? So these are a number of the different sort of methods you see.
Speaking of Russia, tell us about Putin kills Kenny and why the Kremlin backed off shutting down the TV station 2x2, and whether you think Putin and his new clampdown on NGOs, the new law, is he edging towards going too far? Is he losing his sense of humor?
Well, one of the very difficult things that all these regimes have to deal with is their youth population. You know, I was in China 10 days after Mubarak fell, and I talked to one of the Chinese Communist Party's officials who was one of their top experts on the Middle East. And I asked him sort of what he thought was going on in the Middle East from the point of view of China. And he said, you know, I don't know. We don't even have a name for it right now. I mean, again, this was 10 days after Mubarak's fall. He looked like hell. He had been in meetings after meetings after meetings. His eyes, you know, he hadn't slept at all. He said, we don't know. I don't know, Will. But I can tell you this. When you have a population and 60% of it is under 30 years of age, it's like something that's just floating, and you don't know where it's going to go. So in a case of a place like Russia, even there, you have a youth population, which it's sort of interesting that only a handful of years ago, some of Putin's strongest numbers, approval numbers, came from 20-somethings. It was cool to support Putin. It is not cool to support Putin anymore. And in the case that you mentioned, the regime has been very careful and sophisticated in not inadvertently radicalizing this population for the most part. And so a few years ago, there was an instance where one interest group in Russia was offended by some of the programs, American programs, that were being broadcast on this station called 2x2. And one, they was showing, in particular, they were offended by The Simpsons and South Park. And so, you know, the Kremlin didn't really see the minefield here. They said, okay, you don't like this, you matter to us, we are gonna withdraw their license, that programming is off the air. So they take the programming off the air. All of a sudden, for the first time, you had youth protests in Moscow. And they were young people marching in Moscow with signs to say, Putin kills Kenny. Save Cartman, and things like this. And because they, you know, and if I talked to human rights activists there then, young people, who said, you know, if you ask them, are you out here protesting for freedom of speech? They said, no, this is about Kenny. This is all about Kenny. And this is sort of, this is now a few years ago. I think that dynamic has changed. I don't think it necessarily has to be. It's very effective when it is something very concrete that people can identify and say, I am for this, and I don't know about your right to freely assemble. I mean, that's, I don't know. I don't feel that in my everyday life. That doesn't seem like something I need to be that concerned about. But I'm concerned about these things. I think that has shifted now because of the events of the last 7 or 8 months and the protests we've seen there. That you now people see a correlation between their coming to the street and the regime having to react. They haven't had satisfaction. It's not as though they're somehow satiated by what the Kremlin has given them, because they've given them almost nothing. But they understand the regime was worried, and that in itself is a very important learning moment for the opposition there. And when people start to lose that apathy, that's a very dangerous thing.
Let me pick up on that and tell a quick personal story. I happened to have been in Prague in October 1989 on a day when there were massive demonstrations in Wenceslas Square. I was then chairman of Helsinki Watch, and I went over to the home of a dissident leader, Rita Klimova, where all the dissidents gathered, except Havel, who was with us on the phone. And the conversation was, has the revolution started? Because if it has, and we don't press ahead, we'll be damned by history. But if it hasn't started, and we press ahead, we'll be in jail. But we got to decide what we're going to do tomorrow. And they began to develop a checklist of how you would know
in real time that a revolution was underway, what would be on your checklist?
Well, I mean, that's a great question. You know, one thing that came, that I heard time and time again from, and this was an important for me in terms of trying to talk about that side of the equation that wasn't the regime, but talking about the people challenging the regimes, was that we aren't there, and by we, I mean to some degree the media, we're not there paying attention to these movements when they learn how to mobilize. We're not there when they learn how to chip away at a regime's legitimacy. We're not there when they master the tools of propaganda. And we're certainly not there when they learn from each other. I mean, I had many instances where I'm meeting with Venezuelans and they're talking to me about Russia, and Russians talking to me about Egypt and so forth, and learning, and literally having meetings where they're comparing notes. So we're not present for this. And I think that what we do get as consumers of these events is we turn on CNN and we see, well, a million Egyptians come to the same conclusion on the same day, apparently. And one thing that came through is that, and one activist said just this, he said, spontaneity just gets you killed. There's no such thing as a spontaneous revolution. That, in fact, in all of these cases, there's work that's dangerous, but there's as much work that's just tedious that needs to get done. And we weren't paying attention so much in 2005 and 2006 and 2007 when some of these young people in a place like Egypt were trying things, failing miserably sometimes, but going back and then adjusting, making, and so what you see, you asked me a question about a checklist, and so you're gonna hold me to that. So you need to find a core group of people that are committed to this, that have come up with a message that communicates across a broad group of the society. This is not a minority movement game. This is about numbers. Whoever has the majority is going to win this. So you have to be thinking along that way, first of all. Second of all, you need a moment. To say it's spontaneous doesn't mean that there isn't a moment where you're most likely to capitalize on that training. In the case of Egypt, that moment was Tunisia. But you see the planning, and I talk about it in the book, that activists in Egypt knew, okay, one, we were already planning to mobilize on January 25th. That's police day. That's a day that's just inherently offensive to people here because it's a day that we are supposed to celebrate our police, who are the most reviled people under the regime. So we like that as our day to call people out. Two, we've got Tunisia and everyone's watching it, so they might have more courage than they've had. But then there's gritty, granular stuff they start doing, like saying, okay, different activists were given different blocks, different streets. You're to go up and down the street. We've targeted the street because armored vehicles and police can't get their cars into the street. The streets are too narrow. You will start to gather people on this street only when you have reached X number, depending on the size of the street, 500 or 1,000 people. Are you allowed to then go to a bigger street? You'll then go to an avenue. Only when you've gotten to 5,000 will you ever approach the boulevard. We know how many people they expect to have there. We have to have those numbers. And so they went directly to these neighborhoods, many of them poor neighborhoods. They didn't assemble outside the journalist syndicate, which is where at almost any point in Egypt in the last 5 years, if you'd gone, there was a protest outside the journalist syndicate. It was always the same 500 people. And they were trying to find a way to sort of branch out. Technology is important. I can talk more about that later, but it's not... Technology is, I think, it's gotten too much credit for a lot of this work. It's much more political strategy.
And I agree with that. And that evening in Prague, there were four things on the checklist. One was the size of the crowd, bigger than they expected. The second was the composition of the crowd, unusual suspects, people that you wouldn't have expected by profession, class, and so forth. Third, very interesting to me, was a sense that the police were losing confidence and had a reluctance to use all the force available to them. And the fourth was the gray zone. The people who existed in the gray zone, who were kind of a little bit in the government, a little bit outside the government, and they gave the signal. That this is the moment, go for it, and they did, and the Velvet Revolution happened. Talk to us a little bit about, you were talking about the opposition and the sharing of lessons. Talk to us about the founding of Canvas. And why the Serbians have played such a role in the opposition sharing.
I mean, I would say that when I began this book, I was much more pessimistic than when I finished it. And the reason I became more optimistic over time was because of groups like Canvas. And I'll say a little bit about Canvas is led by a man named Serge Popovich. Serge is now, he just turned 38. When he was 28, he was responsible for leading a youth movement that was really the spearhead of the movement that toppled Slobodan Milosevic in 2000. You're 28, you've got one dictator under your belt, you know, kind of, what do I do next? And like many people who were young people that were in that movement, he went into politics. And after about 2 years, he was completely and utterly disenchanted. He told me, I have no interest in arguing about zoning. This is not what I was ever had in mind. I did not understand what this meant. And so he left Serbian politics, and it began sort of ad hoc, where he started getting requests from different people in Georgia, in Ukraine, in Zimbabwe, to come and talk to their group, their youth group, about what they had done in Serbia. And so the way he describes it to me, the moment that he decided to form CANVAS, which is the acronym for the Center for Applied Nonviolent Strategies, was he was in South Africa working with people from Zimbabwe, and they knew everything about what they had done in Serbia. They knew every trick they had played, all the rallies, the political strategies, the messaging, everything. And he just thought, wait a minute, if I travel from Belgrade all the way to this, you know, corner of Africa, and they know what we've done, there's something going on here that's bigger than me that I should be doing more of. This is what I'm supposed to do, not Serbian politics. And so in the last, it's now about 9 years, Canvas has, it's a group of himself, Serge, and four other Serbs who are part of the youth movement in Serbia called OPOR. They have trained democratic movements in more than 50 countries on how to topple their own dictators. And so in the course of reporting for this book, I had met Serge in 2009, and basically wherever I went, I always talked to Serge because he trained somebody there. And then in 2011, he called me and said, could you be someplace in 3 days? And I said, absolutely, I can do that. What's going on? And he said, we're gonna train some activists from the Middle East. And I would love to have you there to watch us do what we do, but there are a couple ground rules. One, you can never say where this workshop took place. Two, you can never say what country these activists came from. And three, you can't name my trainers. You can't name the people who are gonna run this workshop. And I accepted these ground rules in large part because there was no other way. The workshop he runs is identical, whether they be Malaysians, Iranians, Venezuelans, he's trained all of them. It's the exact same workshop because he has two requirements that the people understand before they attend one of these. Is that one, they can have no history of violence. Any history of violence, he won't work with them because he believes a nonviolent solution is the only one that's going to work. And two, they need to understand, they need to clearly have the right expectations that he's not gonna sort of roll out a blueprint for them of, okay, A to Z, this is what you need to do and you're gonna have a democratic future. Rather, I'm going to analyze this problem for you in a generic way because it's the same. And you are gonna take this thinking back, and because you're an expert on your political culture, you'll take it and you'll apply it. Is the educational institution more important in the creation of propaganda there or not? It may not be. Does the police work in this way or that? Is the police force more important than the military, or is the military more important than the police? These are all things that, you know, I can't possibly know, but you know, and with these tools you can apply. And so I traveled to a Mediterranean island and met with Middle Eastern activists and watched them ask their questions and begin to learn. And they were thinking on multiple levels. They were thinking about things like sort of how to communicate a message that could attract a broad enough part of society. They were a minority movement, and they needed to be able to come up with a way to come up with a message that would be interesting and resonate with small businessmen, with academics, with people in a religious institution, and with young people. How do they do that? And so they were working that problem during those days. But in addition, they had very specific questions, like what do you do with the goon on the security squad or the police that just enjoys beating people? How am I nonviolently going to convince the chief of police to stop beating people? And they said, okay, well, we confronted this in Serbia. So very specifically, what you will do is you will take a photograph of him beating a 17-year-old in the street brutally. You'll take that photograph, and you will make posters, and you'll put his cell phone on the bottom of that poster. And then you will plaster that poster where his wife shops. And it'll say, please call X and ask him why he beats our children. And then you'll take that same poster and you'll plaster it on the pathway that he takes his son to school. And you'll put it in his mother's neighborhood. And we cannot change him. We're not going to confront him through the badge. But his wife can change him. His mother can change him. His community can shun him. And he'll think twice before he picks up the baton again. And so it's a combination of both sort of broad strategic thinking and also it's always the case, and I've seen it time and again, where activists are saying, well, wait a minute. Do we run our democratic movement like a young democracy? Because that's what we've been doing. We want our, you know, this. I was heard this question from members of April 6th, again to Serbian activists in 2009, where they said, you know, we want Egypt to be a democracy. So we figure, right, that our movement should be democratic. They turned to them and said, yes, but every meeting you've ever held has been infiltrated by informants from the regime. Yes, we can't, we want to go someplace that the regime's already there. Okay, that's because your democratic movement, when it's a movement, has to be an insurgency. It has to be military in its discipline. You're going to democracy, but you're not going to get there by acting like one today. So these are just sort of small but important lessons that they pick up.
Tell us a little bit more. You begun to draw, I think, on Bob Helvey's work. Talk to us a little bit more about who he is and what his work is.
Bob is a fantastic guy. He is a retired military, lives in West Virginia today, and in Charleston, West Virginia. And he in many ways, a good part of this book is about relationships. It's about relationships and sometimes chance meetings between people, which is what ends up, you know, being the explanation for why information or knowledge is communicated or not. And Bob had been he was a Vietnam vet, decorated. And he had been in the military for almost 30 years. And near the end of his service, he was given an opportunity by the Army to take a year of sabbatical to Harvard. And so he went to Harvard, and he said he was bored. There was nothing going on. And he had, you know, day in and day out, he'd go to different meetings and whatnot. But he said, you know, I had just too much time on my hands. I didn't know what to do. And he saw a meeting going on nonviolent sanctions. And he thought, this sounds like hippies. So I'm going to go to this, and it's going to confirm every prejudice I have about these people who I don't care for. And he went, and it's at this meeting that he met a man named Gene Sharp. And Gene Sharp got up and said, you know, basically nonviolence is about either taking power or preventing someone else from having it. And Bob Helvey was like, that's what I do. I do it with a gun in my hand, but I never thought about it that way. And he ended up, the two of them, Sharp and Helvey, formed a friendship that year. And Bob ended up reading everything Gene had ever written. And he soon retired from the military. And his last posting was as a military attaché in Burma. And he was amazed by Burma because, you know, here was a place where when he talked to people in the street, they would hold up their hand and cover their mouth so that no one could read their lips. If they'd even talk to him at all. And he ended up, after his military service, going back to Burma and beginning to work with the opposition there to train them in Sharp's ideas. And he ultimately brought Sharp to Burma, which led to Sharp writing From Dictatorship to Democracy, which he's written tome after tome. He could fill a library with what he's written, but the thing that that's everywhere I went, people had read, was this sort of condensed version of his thinking, which is, you know, depending on which version you get, it's about 70, 75 pages. And he came out of the Burmese saying, you know, we love your books, but we really need the cliff notes, if you will, to this. Put it all together in one place. And Bob has then went on to do more trainings in country after country. And in 2000, he had a meeting in Budapest where the group of people he walked in the room to train were a young group of Serbs. And so when he met the Serb, Serge Popovic, and the other 10 top leaders of Otpor, he said, I'd never met a more intelligent group of people. And he stays in touch with him now. And so he's in many ways sort of been the linkage for sort of getting many of Gene Sharp's ideas from the page out into the field.
Take you back to Russia. I was in Moscow a couple months ago talking with Ludmila Alexeyeva, longtime head of Moscow Helsinki Committee. And this is just after Putin's re-election. And she said, it's fine. And I was surprised. Well, what do you mean? Well, she said, the opposition isn't ready to rule. And the country has very deep problems. So let Putin get kicked around with those problems. We'll just do stuff to keep him in check. And we got to focus on getting ready because he's past history. She right?
I met with Ludmila when I was in Moscow as well, and if she could hear me, I would never say she could be wrong. But I don't think she's wrong. I think she's right. I think she is right. I think that his political monopoly will never be. He made a number of critical mistakes in these last 8, 9, 10 months, and it'll be very difficult for him to recover because he's losing popular support. I also think she's right in her critique of the opposition. The political opposition in these countries can be every bit as stubborn and slow to change and innovate and think creatively as the regimes itself. That's certainly been the case in Venezuela. And in the case of Venezuela, it's taken more than 10 years, really, for there to be an evolution of the political opposition, where now, I mean, look at the guy who's trying to run against Hugo Chavez, Enrique Capriles. He is, what is he, 41, 42? The most dynamic opposition leaders in Venezuela today are, between 38 and 45. And in large part, they've come up at a different moment. They're part of another generation. They weren't running Venezuela in the 1980s and the 1990s. They're not associated with running that government, that democracy, into the ground. And they are much more creative in how they think about what they need to do. And so, this was a case, I devoted an entire chapter of the book to opposition, political oppositions, because, I went to Egypt in 2006 and met with a member of the opposition there, someone everyone knows and is, and been at it for a long time. And they had just suffered, an enormous defeat for their party in, what we could call an election in Egypt then. And I just said, wait a minute, I know that the game is rigged and whatnot, but when you have a defeat like that, do you think we should change our message? We should try something different? You should try another way of reaching people? And he said, no, we're used to being defeated. Well, change was, no surprise, change did not come from his political party. It came from people who weren't part of the political parties. It came from youth. Many of the youth actually had played a role in these political parties and became disgusted and then left them to take to the methods that they did. So there is a process of evolution, and she's probably right that although I think there's been a great deal of progress in the street, the parties are still catching up.
Let me ask you a hypothetical. Stay with me here while I pose it. It's 2 years ago. And a dictator has asked you to be a consultant, learning that you're working on this book.
Yeah.
Smart guy. I want to move up the learning curve faster. So he invites you, and you agree to go because you think you'll learn something for the book. And so what would you have told Bashar Assad?
So I'm giving Bashar Assad genuine advice.
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
2 years ago, what would you have told him he could have done differently?
Yeah. So whoever's tape recording this is a hypothetical. This is going to haunt me on YouTube for the decades. There are a number of things. I think that, first of all, the first question you want to ask is how many people are using Facebook? What is the internet penetration in this country? Because if it's already happened, then forget about it, it's too late. I mean, when you get a business card from a Burmese official, from the junta, that has their Google Mail address. I mean, it's not gonna take that away That would cause a revolution, probably within the government, to try and take away Gmail accounts from people in Burma. So in some cases, you know, if it's already out of the barn, it's too late. That's the case in Russia. That's the case in Venezuela. It's going to be difficult. So you need, you know, not everyone has the opportunity because they had the foresight to think about it like you had in China. That's one. Two, if you are, you've got a demographic problem. I mean, since we're focusing it on Assad, you've got a demographic problem. And I think that in this instance, the best thing you could do would be start handing out passports. One of the biggest mistakes that I recognized immediately was in a case like Tunisia, where, I mean, really Tunisia is like a test case of what not to do. You do not want to educate all these people, give them sort of really first-class educations, make them technologically savvy, have them graduate from your universities where there is no job waiting for them, and then keep them there. Why Ben Ali didn't give them passports and say, go join the fabulous Tunisian diaspora and send the remittances home, but you know, we would love to see you in Toronto. That would be much better from the point of view of the regime, because these people are not going to be satisfied. You've raised them to have expectations, and then you're not going to fulfill them? A bad, bad idea. You know, in fact, in many cases, you found that the highest levels of unemployment in Egypt were among the most educated, because there were no jobs for people with that level of education. You know, if you were illiterate in Egypt, you had a better chance of finding a job. This is an economy that's not working. Given that you're not going to probably become a miracle on the Nile, you need to think of something else, and you know, getting these hornets out of the nest is a good idea. And I think, you know, beyond that, I think that in some cases they're doing a number of the things correctly. I mean, in the case of Egypt, they were doing the correct thing in allowing there to be some media freedom. The problem is they allowed some of that media freedom to creep onto primetime television. That was a problem. That began to raise expectations. You always want to keep that in your opposition newspapers. You always want to keep that in your small circulation, 10 to 20,000 print publications. It gives people an opportunity to vent. I showed that regime. I wrote that op-ed. They are quivering now. You know, my arguments were devastating. Let them do that. It makes them feel good. It's also really important. You'll notice in China that the greatest degree of media freedom that's taken place has been among financial journalists. Because the regime knows everyone's corrupt, and they want to know who's egregiously corrupt. The only way they're going to find out is from journalists. So they allow that amount of freedom there. So, I mean, but ultimately, you know, depending on your environment, I mean, you know, this isn't the case for someone like Assad, but in the case of Russia and in the case of China, there was a new social compact that was essentially made, which was to say, look, I am not interested in your personal rights or privileges. You know what? You want to hate me? Hate me. You want to denounce me in my home? In your home? Do it. You don't need to have a photograph of me up in the living room. That's fine. But here's the deal. If I get out of your way and I allow you these personal freedoms, in exchange, I get the political monopoly. You get no interest in politics. Stay out of that. We can get along quite fine. Boris Nemtsov, one of the leaders of the Russian opposition, said that he said the difference between communism and Putinism is communism was stupid. Putinism just comes for your personal privileges. It just comes for your political rights, excuse me. It doesn't care about your personal privileges. And that's why Putinism is much smarter. It's much more focused.
I ask one more question, then open it up to all of you. You write about the Sunday stroll protest technique in China. So what marks would you give the Chinese government in dealing with new protest techniques? And you did write, I think, the Chinese Communist Party is the largest, wealthiest, and most powerful political organization in the world, and yet it's also afraid of a flower. Talk to us a little bit about China and what you see happening there.
I've been to China before, but for this book, I arrived in China, like I said, about 10 days after Mubarak fell, and there were a number of people. It was a wonderful time to be there, and it was a terrible time to be there. It was wonderful because, you know, if you could get in with party officials, they were taking this information in just as quickly as the rest of us. And so I had the occasion where I was meeting with a Chinese Communist Party official, and we were going through the sort of the, you know, and it's very good to sort of ask them about some place that's not China, because they, you know, it's much less sensitive. And so we were talking about the situation in Egypt, and I said, well, you know, to what degree are you concerned about that? Something like that could happen here. And he started to go through sort of the bullet points. So, well, Will, what you need to understand is this, and what you need to understand is that, and da 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 da. And you, what you need to understand is that in China we have an ancient civilization. And I just sort of looked at him. And it sort of hit him at the exact same time, and I said, and Egypt would be... And you could sort of see, like, oh, shit. I'm not using that talking point again. Like, you know, just sort of he was revising it right there. Like, I never had a Communist Party official blush, but he did. And so, you know, they were taking this in real time, and one of the things that, you know, to the degree that it surfaced in China, there began to be calls for a Jasmine Revolution. And that happened right as I arrived. And so basically, it was an anonymous call online where people said, look, pick one of these spots around China. The first Sunday, there were 12. I think it grew to almost two dozen. And on Sunday at 2 o'clock, show up on this corner and go for a stroll. Now, going for a stroll was actually, this is a technique that's been used in other places. It was used during solidarity in Poland in the early 1980s. And it's a clever one, because what are you going to do from the point of view of the regime? Are you going to arrest people for going for a walk? Who here is engaged in the political act, and who here is just simply going for a Sunday stroll? And so I went to the place in Beijing that was the appointed corner, and I got there about an hour and a half before people started to assemble. And it's an upscale, very nice shopping area called Wangfujing, and there's a McDonald's at that corner where it had been sort of the focus the week before. And I got there and I walked in. And I've been to this McDonald's before. I went to this McDonald's in 1999, and I walked in, and it's always busy. It's a two floors. It's always full. And you walk in, the place went dead. Everyone just looked. American just walked in. What's going on? You know, here's the CIA has arrived. And I walk in, and people sort of begin to get their composure back, and I go forward and get my food, and I find a place to sit upstairs. And I have never seen that many earpieces in a McDonald's, you know. And I sit down, and shortly thereafter, two gentlemen, I use that liberally, sit down next to me, and they proceed to eat their burgers without ever speaking to each other. And this is getting odd. And so eventually I look down at their shoes, and they have these military issue boots on. So eventually it gets to be too awkward for me to stay. And so I get up to leave, and I'm walking down the stairs. And as I begin to walk down the stairs to the first floor, there were four guys sitting at the table right at the head of the stairs. And you know, you just have that feeling. And so I'm in the middle, I'm halfway down the flight of stairs, and I just stop, and I turn around and look behind me. And they've got a video camera out, and they're videotaping me as I'm leaving the McDonald's and going downstairs. And when you went outside, you know, there were estimates by journalists, other journalists who were there, and I think they were accurate, you know, that probably there were just under 1,000 uniformed police on that block. And probably 2 to 3 times that in plainclothes police. There were times when I was in the group that was going for a stroll, I think, where there were 2 or 3 people with earpieces right next to me. And so what you ended up with was, you know, no one came out that day and said, down with the Chinese Communist Party. They would have been whisked away in a heartbeat. But what happened was you had people there that were clearly there for political reasons. You had some people there who, you know, who were like me, dumb foreign journalists. And then you had an enormous security presence. And what happened was then the security presence made more people come. And then more people come. And, you know, Chinese are just like anyone. We stop and gawk. And so when you saw those crowds, that seems like an incredible number of people on that corner. And the people just kept coming. And the regime, it was very sophisticated in sort of its crowd control techniques. I mean, they started bringing out the street cleaning equipment and started cleaning the corner. And they just cleaned it again and again and again. And like a ballet, we were all sort of moved to one side of the street into another side of the street. And we sort of, it was just like people that was always moving. And they had Rottweilers and Dobermans and whatnot, but it wasn't really intimidating particularly. The government's good at that. But what the government's not good at is sort of revealing how nervous they are about the fact that someone posted on an internet board that, you know, go for a stroll, that it would produce this result, and that result was then replicated across China and all the other sites. You know, the regime is clearly deeply nervous, and it has good reason to be, but I can go into that later.
Well, let's take some questions from the audience. I'm going to ask you to identify yourself, and we'll start with Jim Hogue.
Jim Hogue from the Council on Foreign Relations. Will, that was fascinating. But one of the themes in your remarks really was how much ingenuity and energy is being applied now to get around dictators. Yet, as you well know, for 5 years in a row now, Freedom House's annual report has shown a regression in democratic practices around the world. What are some of the reasons for that, in your opinion?
That's very important. I mean, you know, between 1974, you know, 1974 there were 41 democracies in the world. By 1991 there were 76. By 2005 there were more than 120. And since that point, 2005, we've had this six-year consecutive decline in political pluralism around the world. And that is a big part of why I wrote the book, because I wanted to get at this question of what's going on. And this is, you know, we've spent a lot of time talking about the opposite side of the coin, but it's the sophistication of these regimes itself, that they have found ways in order to maintain their hold on power without tripping across so many of the red lines that the other regimes once did. What we found was that the idea of democracy itself is being proven to be so malleable by these regimes. Some of the successes that were of that democratic wave, Georgia, Ukraine, Kyrgyzstan, and others, are the things that started to begin to unravel, because the space between democracy and dictatorship allows for a large gray zone that they're very effective at exploiting. And so what we find is that it's not that useful, really, as sort of an analytical device to sort of say, okay, let's line up all the democracies in this column and all the dictatorships in this column, and then you wait a minute, I've got a lot of countries I don't know where to put. That's not a mistake.
Alan?
Alan Adler. Could you talk to us about Iran? I'm not sure that that's one of your...
Speak into the mic.
I think I am. Am I in the mic now? Yes?
I can hear you.
Fine. Oh. Talk to us about Iran. A few years ago in Iran, the younger people and some other citizens took to the streets. The government there seemed to be fairly effective after a few days of stemming the tide. The United States stood by, paralyzed, and has been greatly criticized in many quarters for doing that. What role do you think that the United States can play when the people are on the streets? What role shouldn't they play? Is it true that the United States can't get involved? Because if we do, the movement is tainted. Right? What's your view on that?
Right. You know, in the case of the Green Movement in 2009, you have two sort of, I'll speak on that, then I'll answer the part about the United States. You had two sort of stunted actors there. On the one hand, you have a government that still hasn't fully recovered because of the divisions within its own ranks. I mean, one of the first things the Chinese Communist Party did after 1989, beyond the security situation, was purging the ranks of those who were sympathetic with the protesters in Tiananmen Square, because they realized going forward, we can't have a divided opinion on this question. What Deng Xiaoping did on that day was correct. Yes? Yes. So if you don't feel that way, then you're not here anymore. That's one. And Iran can't do that. I mean, the divisions are just so immense within the regime. So that's one of the problems. But on the opposite side, the opposition had those divisions too, because what we were impressed by was young people, the foot soldiers who were sort of going out in this massive show of force of people, you know, rising up against the regime. Well, the people that were leading that movement were former members of the regime. I mean, they were never necessarily there for revolution, necessarily, and they had an agenda which I think really at some point separated from the young people who were part of that movement. So that, I think, is why you had mistakes on both sides, and the regime was able to get its balance back. I mean, when I was actually watching those events with some of the Serbian activists in 2009, and I asked them, you know, this was during the first few days where we just, like, 3 or 4 days in, and the protests went on for months and months. And I said, what do you think's happening? What, you know, what's your sense? And they said, one, we've trained 7 groups there. And so we know what they're telling us. And the problem is that the graybeards are still in charge. That's one. Two, it's about to get bloody because they're now making mistakes. It was fantastic what they did initially, this show of force of how many people were there and were sympathetic. But what would be the next most frightening thing from the point of view of the regime would be if those people just disappeared. Why stay in the square? Leave the square. You're becoming a sitting target for the regime. Much more impressive would have been if they could have shown their organizational strength by disappearing and then reappearing in the 10 next biggest cities. You have to calibrate your tactics to the level of repression in the country. And so in a place like Iran, where the repression is real, you have to come up with tactics that are visible but are low risk. And they were beginning to move into high-risk tactics and then just sitting there. And when you lose the momentum and the regime knows what you're going to do tomorrow, the outcome is sort of set. Now, the United States, these regimes are not particularly concerned about the United States. And they don't have much reason to be, because in most instances, the United States and these regimes are joined at the hip. We buy most of Venezuela's oil. We give the Egyptian military $1 billion a year. The Chinese government, the US government, we are leading trading partners. Russia, we can accomplish almost nothing diplomatically without courting Russia's opinion. So these regimes aren't particularly concerned about getting intense pressure for regime change from the United States when we share so many common interests. What these regimes are concerned about, what they worry about, is their own populations. Because they understand that's where the change will come. It will be indigenous if it comes and if it's real. A case like Libya, well, yes, okay. If you have a maniacal dictator who comes out into the public square and promises to commit gross humanitarian violations, thereby giving the moral high road to anyone who opposes him, and is then challenged by his population, which is able to partition the country effectively and push him back on his heels, and there's an international coalition that is then willing to act, and most of the operations are run by the French, yes.
We have two questions
ready. As soon as we get that fact pattern again.
We have two questions ready.
Hi, I'm Mary Lou McFedrin from Canada, and I wanted to thank you in the chapter on Egypt for starting with a profile of a young woman. And extend that to a question. Most of the profiles, as far as I can tell from the book, were men. And what would you say about, is there an emerging role for women? What's your experience from the overview?
Well, I mean, I think it's varied. In the case of Egypt, I had arrived in Egypt after the uprising, and in the first day, I had 7 or 8 people come to me and say, hey, did you hear about the torture? Did you hear about the torture? And what they were referring to is the forced virginity tests on 17 women who were dragged from Tahrir Square on March 9th, well after we think of Mubarak has fallen, but, they were victimized by the military. She had just come out of the prison and through someone else, this was a woman who, I ended up meeting her fortuitously because I was there, and I said to her at the outset, I said, look, if you don't want to talk to me, don't talk to me. And she said she did. And I said, well, look, if you want to talk to me, don't give me your name. Now, I'm not supposed to tell you that. I'm supposed to get your name right now, but I'm just going to say, just don't give me your name. And she said, no, this is my name, this is my story, and so she proceeded to go through it. And when it was all over, I said, now you've said it. It's out there. You've explained everything to me that has happened to you. I want to ask you again, if you feel differently about it, do you want me to use your story? Do you want to go off the record? I can do this. That's fine. And she said, okay, you've asked me this a few times. I'm going to do this differently. You can only report my story if you use my name. I am insisting. What made her say that is the same thing that made her ultimately challenged the Egyptian military in Egyptian courts and to win the first judgment that I've ever heard ever being coming against the Egyptian military, which now forbids them from using these practices. And she's won 2 judgments against the military in that space of time. Now, we can argue about whether or not the judgments will be implemented or honored, maybe, but this is a person of incredible courage. And what I found, you'll find that almost, I did more than 200 interviews for this book, almost all of them are on the record when they're not, it's almost certainly someone from the regime. It's not these people, because these people will tell you first, you know, look, if I live in the shadows, that's where the regime will do its worst. So please, you know, get our story out. In terms of women, you know, I think in a place like Venezuela, you see some of the most exciting and interesting politicians, opposition politicians, are women. I spent a lot of time with someone like, Maria Corina Machado, who is an independent politician. She co-founded her own NGO years ago. She would both be an election expert in Venezuela, but she's also an incredibly charismatic person. So in general, whether male or female, what I found is that these people, they come from all walks of life. They're just like anyone. These people weren't trained in this. And what's most impressive about them, why when I would leave country after country, I would sort of be left with this feeling that I don't want to be in opposition to these people, is that they're not romantics. They are hardened, calculated, pragmatic, realistic, and tough as hell. And that's true of the men and the women.
We'll take three more questions in the back.
Mr. Dobson, thank you for your interesting talk. There's another...
Introduce yourself, please.
Further away.
Yeah.
Oh, yes. My name is Aris Christodoulou. There was another important book recently published, Why Nations Fail. It was written by two professors from Cambridge, Massachusetts. They postulate a theory that nations succeed when they have broad dissemination and sharing of power, both political and economic power. If either fails, the nation eventually fails. I think your book takes a similar discussion in the sense that it addresses these mechanisms of failure through political concentration and the opposition to that political concentration. So I think both books are complementary and reinforce each other. I just wanted to make that point.
Yeah, well, I mean, one thing to say there is just that, that's the key tenet. The thing that has not changed about the dictatorship of the 20th century, the 21st century, is that it's about the centralization of power. It's, you know, what these regimes are trying to do is put as much power as possible in a few hands. And that is an anachronism for the reasons that the authors of that book point out. I mean, that is, on some level, almost a fool's errand. But what's different is that if you're going to do this, if you're going to be able to not just survive, but in some cases thrive in this hostile environment for dictatorships, you know, in a period of time when you have a decline of political pluralism around the world, how do you explain that? It's because there's an architecture to authoritarianism. What these regimes, faced with all these pressures, have done is they've come up with a way to actually control for some of the downside of that centralization. I mean, in the case of Putin, you know, he made the Duma, the Russian legislature, a rubber stamp. But he understood that there was a cost to doing that. That when he did that, when you get a legislature that's filled with yes men, that you've lost information that you would typically, in a democracy, get from your legislature. Those people are closer to the people. They'll tell you if this idea is good or bad. You'll get a public reaction. Well, when you don't get it, you've lost it. And now there's a margin for error there. So what did he do? He created a new institution called the Public Chamber. And that organization is made up of people who are experts in media, law, human rights, a number of things. Some of them are actually critical of the regime. They advise on laws that are submitted to the Duma as to whether or not this is a good idea or not. What's different? They have no power to vote. They can't change anything. Their opinions are just their opinions. I talked to the person who basically created the Public Chamber. He's one of Putin's political advisors. And I said, isn't the regime concerned about the complacency that creeps in with mass centralization? And he said, that's exactly what Putin says.
Next to the last question.
Hi, thank you. My name is Robin Barr, and my question is about Syria. I have read that there are over 100 separate insurgent organizations that are part of this whole revolt. Is that so? And if that is so, how do you coordinate? How do you bring that together into any kind of coordinated activity?
I don't know how many there are. I think what we can say is, yes, they're fractured. And there are a number of things that have happened here that are concerning. One, they chose to operate, to confront the regime with violently. They may succeed. you know, in weeks and months to come, they may succeed. But in the last 100 years, violent insurgencies have succeeded 25% of the time, whereas nonviolent ones have succeeded 50% of the time. So they've chosen a path that is much less likely to succeed, if nothing else. And what is born out of this fighting, who knows? I mean, it's not necessarily the case that it's much easier. We see this even in an environment like Egypt, which was a nonviolent and by most measures a fairly disciplined reaction to the regime, that there was a great deal of agreement about, I'm against Mubarak. But when Mubarak was leveled, it became much easier for the military to divide opinion because the people, those people that were able to make common cause in January and February of 2011 no longer could. They couldn't, you know, those relationships couldn't withstand creating a proactive option of what was supposed to follow Mubarak. So in the case of Syria, I'm glad you brought it up, Syria, because we should mention it. I think that the opposition is in many ways made it much more difficult for themselves than they need to, and the fact that they are fractured, whether it be 50, 75, or 100, is very alarming. In the case of the regime itself, Assad learned more from his father than he did from his fellow regimes. I mean, in 1982, his father brutally crushed an uprising in Hama by killing more than 25,000 people in the space of a month. Now, we have no, and here's the difference though, we have no, we don't, some estimates are 40,000, some are 25,000. We don't know how many people. There was no one there to capture it. We have no video images of that crackdown where again, military helicopters were brought into a city and just mowed people down. But unlike that, now his son chooses the same methods, but every day we're able to watch what's going on. Every day we see what the regime's doing. The regime said, no foreign journalists allowed 17 months ago. How much has that mattered that they issued that edict? It hasn't mattered at all. And as a result, you know, in Syria in 1983, 84, was there condemnation for what Assad did then? Yes, there was. But in 1984, Syria was pretty much Syria. It was Syria that it was in 1980. It hadn't changed that much, and it didn't suffer isolation as a result of that. Whatever happens in Syria today, whatever happens, if somehow he's able to cling on to the country or some corner of it, will that regime ever be the same again? No, it won't. And that's the difficult waters that a dictatorship tries to swim in today.
Jack Hamlin, we'll give you the last question.
Yes, I'm Jack Hamlin from Hunter College, Roosevelt House. First of all, I want to thank you for what I really take to be a very optimistic presentation. Hearing all of these things that can be done is very exciting. My question is about the United States, and obviously the United States is not an authoritarian regime. We do not have some of the problems of the countries that you're studying, but there's one thing that you said that struck me as quite similar, which is the situation of educated young people. We are producing a very large class of people who are educated at great cost, often entering into huge debt as they graduate from college and have to pay it off pretty quickly, and are, under present conditions, unemployable. Do you think this is something that has any, should the next president, whoever that may be, worry about this? Do you think that it has any potential for some kind of similar actions as those you've been talking about?
I mean, I actually get this question a lot about making comparisons to the United States. And, you know, I think there are ways, you know, look, there are aspects of our system as much as I'm very happy to have been born and raised here that are fundamentally undemocratic. And we want those aspects in there, apparently, because we see them as being vital to the checks and balances of our system. I mean, the Federal Reserve, not democratic. The fact that we were waiting with bated breath to find out if we'd have health care based on what five men would come to an opinion of, that's not democratic. I mean, that's a check on our more democratic elements of our system. And so it is the case, that I think, that when you look at some states in our union where there is effectively one-party control, it shouldn't be surprising to us that we see, actually in a democratic system, certain authoritarian impulses coming forward. I mean, Republicans in the state of Georgia have introduced legislation that, I kid you not, is directly out of Putin's playbook into how to deal with Occupy protesters. So it is the case that there can be overlap. I don't want to trivialize, though, with the types of risks and challenges that people are up against in these other countries, which is of something of an order of magnitude that's completely different. I mean, at the end of the day, these people that are in debt and unemployable, they have other options that they can begin to consider that don't have anything to do with the United States, that they can freely consider outside of the United States. They have a freedom of movement that they just isn't necessarily the case in these other places. In some cases it is, because as I said, you know, in some of these places, there's nothing particularly repressive about walking the streets of Moscow. You know, Moscow is New York in so many ways, but and that is part of the genius of the system. But no, I think to your question, I mean, I think that there are elements where you can. I don't think we're on the. You know, I don't think he's a socialist dictator, and I don't think we're on a slow slide to authoritarianism. But you, the democracy you have is defined by how well you take care of it. I mean, it was an imperfect experiment, but there was a democracy in Russia for a short period of time in 10 years. Venezuela is the oldest democracy in South America, and for 20 years, it worked pretty well, and then for the next 20 years, it was an abysmal failure, and Chavez is a consequence of that failure. So I do think we are ultimately responsible, and the one thing I heard again and again and again from all these places is the thing that scares the hell out of these regimes more than anything else is participation. And so it's the degree to which we participate in our own politics that I think is the greatest guarantee that it will remain akin to what we'd like it to be.
Well, thank you, Will. You've given us a great evening. And thank you all for coming and participating. And if we'll allow Will to go through the aisle here, he can get upstairs and sign some books for you. It's a great book. Buy it.